about planner painting. I wanted to show you how lightweight it is to work in pastels. I just have this little lightweight day pack, which weighs 5 pounds. I can pick it up with my little finger. In it, I have Sennelier's landscape plein air pastel kit, which you'll see as we go along. Real lightweight, complete. And then I have a little thing I've made, which is out of foam core. And this is what I'm going to put my pastel paper on. I'll tape it when we're out there. This here is actually wet, dry, black sandpaper, 320 grit. My favorite thing for anything 8x10 or less. So I'll tape that to this foam core book that I've made, which will protect the piece. And then there's another little gator foam thing that I've made that fits in the bottom of my easel, my lightweight easel. And the lightweight easel is just a $30 item that I got at a website called Displays To Go. Two, like the number two. And it's just a real lightweight thing, quick release. This is what I put my little foam core board on. And so you'll see how quick and easy it is to work with it. So one of the things I like about this is I'm not a real big person, and it just makes it a lot easier to go out plein air painting than to drag along a 15-pound, you know, like French easel and so forth. Sometimes I actually keep it even lighter and I don't even bring the easel. I just sit on the ground if the situation's conducive, and that makes it just like going on a hike. So off we go. We're heading towards Coffee Pot. About to enter the trail. We've just walked about a block and a half from our house. This is Sugarloaf Mountain, and behind it is Coffee Pot, and that's what we'll be painting today. There's a little trail here that goes between the houses, and that's where we're headed. Okay. We're just part way up the trail now to where it takes a turn on this bluff that overlooks Sedona, and in the distance is Jerome and Mingus Mountain. Plein air painting really has its advantages. It gets you more in touch with nature. This here is Thunder Mountain, also called Capitol Butte, and it's a beautiful mountain, but I don't paint it very often, and the reason is that the side that we can see it from most of the time is usually the light's on it rather directly. It's kind of flat, and you don't get much articulation of shadows. Maybe at the end of the day or something. Right now, it's early morning in December, and if you look over here to the right, this is what we're going to do. We're going to do the Coffee Pot formation. See the spout on the upper right part of that rock on the right? It's kind of the spout of the coffee pot, the old-fashioned coffee pot. I often do this rock because it has a lot of interesting articulations, you know, winter or summer, just about any time of day. Of course, as the day moves on, it usually becomes less favorable for plein air painting because the light gets more flat. However, something you can do, even in the middle of the day, you can turn around and face the sun and look at something like this tree here. So if you can do that, you can, for maybe a couple of hours, the lighting won't really change that much if you're facing into the sun in the middle of the day. With something that's backlit and close up like that. What a beautiful formation that is, right? And there's a lot of interesting angles that you could, you know, do it from. And right here is kind of a freeway because there's a lot of people hiking through here. So we're not going to do it here, but I'm going to take some pictures. Taking pictures is not the same thing as plein air, but there are those days that you're in the studio or at nighttime or whatever, or just for a reference of what you've already done. It's useful. So now we're leaving the Sugarloaf Trail, which is also, I think, Teacup Trail here, and we're going to go on a side trail off of it up here to Coffee Pot. It'd be nice if you could climb all the way up to the pass through Coffee Pot, but it gets a little too dense and difficult. I'm going to use this white artist tape to tape the eight, a little bit bigger than 8x10 piece of black sandpaper, it's 320 grit, I believe, to this board. I have already put on this board some plastic packaging tape so that when I do this repeatedly, it doesn't, you know, tear off the surface of the foam core. Okay, we moved up the path a little bit so we could have a better way of framing everything. So I'm going to start now, and the first thing I'm going to do is going to lay in my composition. So it's nice to have a lead in. I'm going to just roughly do the outlines of the mountain here. Okay, I'm just going to put it in pretty lightly, so I'm not too committed yet to the composition. So I'm going to exaggerate the lead in here. And so I'm going to bring this path that's down at the bottom here, I'm going to bring it up a little bit higher into the composition. Paths are always an interesting way of leading into a composition, and they also give a nice sense of mystery to a piece. So these are the shrubs here, and this is there's a yucca cactus over here. So I think we're pretty good. I'm going to leave out the scraggy dead tree here. All right, so as you can see, I've laid the lid of my box underneath the other one, and what I do is I just put the pieces down here that I'm using. So I'm going to start, in this case, with the sky. And I just kind of intuitively went to this kind of purplish blue color, which is very beautiful. And although it's a more blue kind of day, and we will bring some of that into it. So I'm going to bring a little bit of the more bluish color in here too, because it really is a vivid blue day in Arizona. It's so nice in the winter here when you get these beautiful blue skies and kind of warm days. As you can see, I don't even need a jacket. It's not that I'm trying to encourage anybody to move to Sedona, okay? There's plenty of people here. So one of the neat things about Sedona is it's a natural place of complementary contrasts. You can see how, you know, the orange and the blue, which are opposites on the color wheel. And that's one of the reasons I think that people find Sedona so beautiful. It's, you know, it's also has contrasts of elements like the vertical cliffs and the horizontal, you know, waters at different places and so forth, like Red Rock Crossing. And contrast is one of the main principles of art. You can contrast colors, shapes, you know, forms, near and far, textures, one versus many. There's just so many ways you can have lines that go this way and then lines that go that way, verticals, horizontals, you can have thick lines, thin lines. So I try to remember all of that. And actually, the way I see it, there are three main principles in art, and really they're principles in life. And the first one, which is so subtle, we often don't really even acknowledge it, is unity. So everything's, all of nature is unified, you know, in our, you might say the formless space behind everything is kind of the field in which all this unity happens. So when I use a colored ground like this, extra stuff there, when I use a colored ground like this, it automatically gives a sense of unity to a painting. So that's the formless. In the world of form, that's where we have contrasts and dualities. So that's the second principle. The third principle is simply how to integrate and balance those different dualities and contrasts so they don't get too extreme. It's kind of what I call balance, harmony. That third principle is like where you do composition, drawing, you look at the relationships between things. So now I'm going to establish, first of all, some of my lightest lights, which will be this coffee pot spout, the one we wonder, could this fall off someday? And some of my darkest darks. You don't want your lightest lights and your darkest darks all over the painting. You want to have kind of a center of interest to which the eye automatically goes. Now up here at the top, you'll see some of these more blonde formations, which are just a different type of staining that got on the rocks at that particular point in history. One of the nice things about doing this formation, and I do it a lot, is it has so much articulation, especially in these places here. And when we first moved here, it was pretty, and it still is, kind of complicated sometimes to follow. Like, where am I? You know, which one of these bluffs am I on? It's easy to lose your place compared to, say, figure drawing, you know, where our eyes are so familiar with seeing figures that it's really pretty easy to keep your place. So this is one of my favorite kind of neutral grays, and I use it next to the yellow. Again, here we have a complementary contrast. It's basically yellow and purple, which are opposites on the color wheel. So, and look how that brings kind of a glow into the shadow area here. So I'm kind of establishing some of that, and I'm going to leave some of the black areas here to help unify the painting and to articulate the form. And bring a little bit of this orange back in here. I like to work kind of all over the painting. I mean, some people, usually when they're doing a detailed studio piece, will just like engineer a painting and just like photograph and just work, you know, one little bit, you know, and just kind of work out and get it all done. A lot of artists, especially those that work in a looser format, like to kind of go back and forth, check out, you know, relationships at different parts of the painting, and that's more how I work. There's more than one way to do it, though. But I would say probably most of the artists that I've studied with do the, you know, the method of looking kind of all over the piece, working all over the piece and going back and forth. So now I'm just kind of using the broad side of the pastel to kind of glaze in the body of the rock here. And then I'm going to stand back for a minute and see how do I like this. And it's coming along okay. It's not the most exciting piece I've ever done of coffee pot rock. Those tend to happen on stormy days. But I'm grateful that it's not a stormy day, honestly. We tried filming this the other day in Jerome, and it was so windy and blustery, we had to just ditch it. Okay, now I'm bringing in a little bit more of a stronger purple here to emphasize the deeper part of the shadow. And I think I'll bring this over here in this whole area here too. I'm just gonna glaze that on to start with. Kind of, you know, sort of posterize it, do the main masses that are here. And then I think it's time to start putting in the tree. The trees, I should say. Now I'm gonna put, although trees are red, are green, I'm going to put in a little bit of red here because it's a complementary color to green. And it will help to kind of pop it as I put it in. I don't want to overdo that because I only get so many passes with pastels. Now, I wish I had some more really perfect greens for this, and I don't just seem to have them. They make them a little too bright or a little too dark. There's a lot of these kind of subtle, sagey kinds of greens out in the desert. It's not like back east. It's mostly bright yellow greens. So this kit's a little bit lacking in some beautiful, like, olives or whatever. Or maybe I've just used them up by now. Okay, so, all right. So then here in the foreground is a little bit more of a bright shrub. This is called the sugar bush here. It's a lot like a photinia that's used in domestic landscaping. And it's a nice native shrub. However, I found it really difficult to try to plant them. They seem to get subject to a root rot when you do them artificially in your landscape. Now, one of the mistakes that people make sometimes is putting in every single leaf on a plant. You know, even in a style that's kind of more realistic than I do, it just gets kind of tedious. You know, it's like you lose the freshness of a piece. So oftentimes the best part of a painting is really the first 10 minutes. And some of the pieces that I've done, been the most successful with in terms of awards and sales, have been those that I've done in about 20 minutes, 20 to 40 minutes. So I'm kind of learning from that, you know, that I've got to be really careful not to overdo it. And you'll help me do that today, right? So now I'm looking for kind of a good gray here. It's actually kind of a grayish green. Actually, this is sort of the green I need. This is the one I was looking for. So You know, gray is an interesting thing. A really good teacher I had back in California, Tom Allen, Aptos College in the 1980s, said gray is the key to color. And what he meant by that was that, first of all, if you saturate every color, it gets too garish. You know, if you make everything bright, it's just too garish. But also, there is, in this, back to that principle of balance, there is between two opposites like red and green. If you mix them equally, they make a perfect, beautiful gray. Same with opposites like yellow and purple. And so what he was pointing out was that these are kind of proof of the divine order that's in the universe. And that really stuck with me. You know, I thought, wow, that is really, you know, as above, so below. I mean, it's like, it's not an accident the way things are. Now I'm bringing in a suggestion of this path down below. A path is an element that, in my mind, expresses the unity principle. How can that be? Well, here's how I see it. Unity is really about, you might say, the spiritual in life, you know, or the formless, the mystery that's there. And a path kind of symbolizes our journey, the journey of the soul, to understand, you know, the mysteries of life as best we can, to return to the source, maybe after we die. And when there's a mystery to a path, you know, you don't just see exactly where it goes, it kind of parallels or expresses that mystery in life. Now I'm putting a little bit of detail right here in this shrub, and that helps to bring your eye to the path, the element of the path. So the things that draw the eye are contrasts, strong contrasts, and detail. So when you want to kind of have the eye kind of go away, then keep it a little bit more soft. Now, like right here, I'm going to point out there are two kinds of edges. There are lost edges. I'm almost done. There are lost edges. They're soft ones like this, and then there's hard edges that, you know, express the form more clearly. And you want to have kind of a balance. Again, balance. Third principle. You want to have a balance of both of those things. Now, just for fun, I'm going to bring a little bit more of this brighter blue in here and sharpen up the edge there, because it really is very pronounced on this part of Coffee Pot Rock. So what I'm going to bring in a little bit of a lighter color here and just draw that edge. You'll see how there's kind of a strata to the rock here, you know, from the many layers when this was like 12,000 feet under the ocean and forming layer after layer of sedimentary sand deposits. When I first moved here, you know, one of the mistakes I made was I started making the rocks look a little bit too much like plants. So I could have the horizontal things and then the vertical erosion things, and then, you know, if I wasn't careful, you could lose your place and just kind of make it ends up looking like a plaid fabric, and that's not good. So, I'm getting better at that. Now up here we have an interesting little articulation that comes up, and it's interesting too in that it leads us, it leads the eye to the top. And that, that's interesting. Again, it's suggestive of the kind of the spiritual element. Now I'm gonna do something right now. This is actually coming along faster than I expected. I'm gonna stand back for a minute and just kind of critique this and see, like, how close am I to done? You know, what bothers me and what doesn't. It's a good idea when you're working to do that as much as possible. Well, the first thing I see is that this is a little bit, it's interesting, but it doesn't quite express the form accurately. This might be a little too bright. This might need a little bit of softening here. Maybe it's a little bit too much black, or maybe not. It could be just fine like it is. It's probably kind of a saleable piece like it is, but I'd like to make it more than just saleable. I'd like to make it something I'm really satisfied with. So, it's a little bit of a challenge to do that while talking, but not too much. It seems like for some of us, our right brains and our left brains, I don't know, work independently. I can, as long as I'm talking about art, I can kind of talk forever while I'm painting. If you start asking me questions about my past or something, it wouldn't work. All right, so I'm going to articulate this, the spout, a little bit more. And I'm going to bring in a little bit of gesture here. a little bit, I'm going to use it, bear down the pastel, bring a little bit of curve in there. That made it more interesting, I think. So we could use a little bit more of this purple shadow around these points of articulation, I think. So gotta be careful again. I don't overdo it here. You know, in this area right here, this is an example, there's always a bit of a back glow when there's a lit rock like this one here and there's a shadow next to it. If you take just a photograph of it, and this, you know, may be hard to tell from the digital image you're going to be looking at, but sometimes those shadows get kind of darkened out, you know, in your photography, and it's one of the advantages of working in plein air, is that the human eye actually sees a pretty broad range of values. You can see into the shadows. And so, you know, if you were just to take a picture of this and take it back home and work it entirely at home, you know, it may not be as successful. However, that said, when I have found it to be successful is when there's a really special moment of light, you know, there's some dramatic clouds behind it, and there's something that's just only going to last about, you know, 2 minutes at the most, then, you know, you can make a really good studio piece. But it helps if you've already been out there in nature and you kind of understand what's going on. Now, right now, I'm using this pinkish color to bring out some of these holes or these openings in the shrubbery. One way that you can do shrubs, and that some people do, like Kurt Walters says, is you can just kind of do basically a geometric circular form and then come back in and carve out the edges and the sky holes. And that's an interesting way to do it too. I really like line. You know, I think it's one of my strengths maybe. I'm going to get another pencil here, a darker one. And so I like the gesture. You know, the gesture of line can be expressive. So I like to contrast, you know, some of the directions in line. So this is kind of pointing up, you know, towards the rock, which is really more of our center of interest. So this is just kind of framing it. And it looks to me like we could use a little bit of highlight on this. So I found here a kind of an olive green here, which might be light enough and it might not. And both an advantage and a disadvantage to pastels is that the colors are pre-mixed. Advantage of that, you can work very quickly. The disadvantage of it is that you may not get the color you want. But you can, of course, mix them up like this, much like the Impressionists would put different colors next to each other, and together the eye interprets them as a third color. So that's what I'm doing now. Don't quite have the green I want, and that's just as well. So this is looking pretty good. Again, I need to fix this part up here. What is that saying here? So I kind of lost my place here. It's like, where are we? We're up there, okay. I don't want to overdo it though, because it will take away, if I put too much light up there, it will take away from our main center of interest, from this rock right here. So I'm going to just keep it a little bit vague. And I like it actually. I'm liking it more and more when, hello, little moth there. I'm liking it more and more when I keep the edges a little bit unexpressed, you know. It's a little bit like a Richard Schmid portrait, where he'll have the whole background kind of smushed out, and then there's a lot of detail as you work in towards the center. So a little bit more detail here. Might use a little bit of a pastel pencil to kind of sharpen that edge. I have an assortment of maybe 10 or so pencils that I use, and a lot of times I don't use any of them, or very few of them. And I'm not getting too much contrast there. So what I might do is take a little bit of this blue pencil and carve the sky back in there next to it. We'll just see how it turns out. You know, most of art is really an experiment. You just try something and you see how it works out. And sometimes you really hit it, and sometimes you don't. And just like anything in life, you know, it's like you just have to kind of accept that. And I think sometimes when I've been teaching, I found that sometimes beginners get discouraged if they don't hit it the first, you know, early stages, and you just have to be patient with yourself and also let go of any of those old voices from the past where somebody said you weren't any good. And just keep trying. You know, 90% of a good art is just putting in the mileage, you know, how much you actually just keep doing it. You know, a very small part of it, I would say, is native talent, whatever that is. It's mostly just having an interest in it and doing it. And then you get better and better at it, hopefully. So it's my opinion, it could be wrong, but it's my opinion that pretty much anybody can be a good artist that wants to do it. You just have to want to do it. Just like, you know, you might have some limitations, like let's say you're blind, that wouldn't help you. Just like if you were handicapped, it'd be hard to win the Olympics, right? But there's always a few shrubs up there. It's amazing how they can grow at those heights there. I have to be careful not to overdo it. Okay, I'm going to put a little bit more highlight on this here, these trees here, because they kind of frame the view again of the mountain, the butte, Coffee Pot Rock. Where we live, we can actually see this rock from our house, and it looks so different, you know, when you're, depending on how far away you are from it, sometimes it looks really tall, and as you get closer up to it, it gets more short and stalwart looking. From some angles, like over there, it really looks pretty awkward. You know, fortunately, we don't have that awkward angle from where we live. But we do have pyracantha shrubs and neighbor's trees that are starting to block it. So I just have to come out and do some plein air painting. Okay, so now I'm going to articulate these shadows a little bit more, and it kind of holds the corner of the painting. You don't want the eye to be taken away, you know, off the corner. You want it to kind of keep kind of enclosing things and drawing into your center of interest. Somebody said once, like, you don't want, also, like, you wouldn't want a figure looking out right that way, because it, what happens is it takes the eye to the next person's painting in the display, you know. Okay. I'm going to step back again, take a look at this, and kind of critique it. It's looking a little bit plaidish. Maybe if I soften this a bit. But the thing that's interesting about painting is, like, there's so many choices you can make. You know, again, like life. You know, there's a lot of parallels between art and life. I mean, at every moment, every day, we have all these choices, right? And painting just kind of reminds you of it. It's interesting when you're in a class and you can see what different ways, you know, people will, how differently people will interpret the same scene. One of the things that I have found about that is that I think that each person's style, if you will, or their expression, how they express, you know, the media they like to use, the degree of contrast and so forth, even the colors, kind of reflects aspects about their personality or about what makes them a distinct individual. You can often notice that people will be wearing the same colors of clothing, or maybe that's not, it's kind of true for me today, isn't it? As what they're painting. That's not surprising since people, you know, have favorite things, but it is interesting. Nice thing about this location is no one's come by this whole time we've been here. Makes it easier to film and easier to work. Okay, I'm going to put in just a few little suggestions of things here, like some twigs here, and then we have a little bit of, I'm going to transplant this yucca over here a little bit, one of the advantages of being an artist rather than a photographer. And then, you know, often less is more, so I'm just going to have a few suggestions of the twigs here. And so that adds a little, what did that do? Not only does it hold the corner of the painting, but it also creates contrast. And the contrast in this case is the one of texture. We have some broad strokes and we have some thin strokes. Now this is looking, it's interesting, but it might be a little bit overkill in terms of, I don't know, I think maybe it needs a little something to soften it up here. or give it some more articulation. Like, what is that exactly? Here's where I'm going to slap my hand. I've got to be careful I don't make it look like a plaid. Alright, I think I'm just fooling around at this point. I think we're kind of done. This is one of the fastest pieces of coffee pot I've ever done, but it just feels to me like it's about time to quit here. Now, what made this a relatively successful piece? One, it's a decent composition. I think the lead-in here, you know, brings your eye to this major point. It helps probably that I've done it before. It's not the first time I've ever done coffee pot rock. And again, I would say that the black background, you know, is a real key to this. It just kind of unifies the painting. I'm going to put a little bit more articulation in here because it, see, what something like this does here is it's a connecting point. It connects this mass and this mass. And what is that doing? It's expressing unity. Connections are unity. And it's also, you could say, it's a form of balance. I'll do a little bit more of that here. Not to overdo it, but I think we could just use a little bit more of that connection. And it feels like over here we could use a sharp edge. I know I said it was done, but I lied. All right, so. So this, I'm going to exaggerate the lightness of it. It feels like it could work there. And the reason is it draws the eye back into the connection with this mass. I don't think we need this green right here. I'm going to lose that. Okay. Now I want to point out a few other things here. See this purple here, here, and here, it's repeated three times. That is a principle, whoops, smeared some blue on there. That is a principle that the Impressionists picked up from Asian painters. They found that repetition of a color, you know, in at least 3 to 5 places, usually an uneven number like that, is a way of expressing harmony in a piece. And you can see some of that here too. Here, this red kind of comes through in this area, and here. The blue, well, kind of accidentally got in here a little bit. Hints of it here. This light purplish blue, kind of here, here, here. I'm just kind of noticing it now. I didn't really plan that out, but it's something that happens kind of naturally when you are working all over the painting and you're holding a stick of color or a brush of color in your hand. I'm going to articulate this just a little bit more because I can with this. Where these lines happen. Uh-oh, that might be a mistake. Something didn't look pleasing there. Maybe it's this here needs to be connected, okay. You know, I kind of, when I first saw this dead tree over here, I thought, nah. No, I'm thinking maybe so, a little bit more of that. All right, I think we're done. So I'm going to sign it now, and I like to sign it fairly subtly. Some people like to just make their name so readable. I just want to, you know, have it there for archival purposes, and it didn't show up, so I'm going to use a different color. And I try to make it a little bit part of the design. Okay, so one of the most time-consuming parts of using pastels is putting everything away where you can easily find it again. So I organize it pretty much warms on one side, greens in the middle, and the cool colors on the other side. And then I try to put the light colors, you know, at one end and the dark colors at the other, like up here. And, you know, I don't get it perfectly because it just takes too long, you know, but it helps me find everything later on. So I'm going to put these light, warm colors down there. This kind of mid-tone orange can go up here. And the greens. And then, you know, I don't always, of course, have the perfect number of slots available. You may notice that some of the pieces I don't use very often, like this bright red, are still pretty big, full half sticks. And some of the ones I use pretty often, like these greens, you know, they're pretty much used up. And I could replace them with sticks in, that I can buy individually, like this one here. But these things here, the sennelier sticks, they almost break just by touching them, you know. Whereas the ones that come with the box, see how they're a little bit thicker. the half sticks that they make. They're much sturdier, and I really like them a lot. There's an example of one of those. And there are other pastel brands that are completely valid too that people like. So I just have stuck with the Sennelier plein air ones because I like it. And if you're interested, I'm going to be giving a workshop in April 2018 here in Sedona. It will be a plein air workshop. It will be held at a friend's beautiful home with lovely views and garden views, and we will also go out in nature like this. And I'm going to encourage people to use a lightweight pastel setup, but if pastels aren't your thing and you want to bring, you know, oils or acrylics, I'm experienced with those and can advise you on all that too. So, and if it's already past April 2018, you might just check my website and see if there's anything else happening. And I do have some blogs. One I recommend that's been the most popular is The Magic of Glazing. All right, thank you.